But
Marion,
you all have worse than me.
Wait, no, Marion, can I just say something to you?
Okay.
What you're feeling is a normal feeling. I had the same thing, and I couldn't wait for it to be over. So I understand where you're coming from. You're not being cruel or anything else like that. You can no longer see him.
But there is a difference.
Yeah.
You've met him. He does not have Alzheimer's. He could come in, he could have a conversation with any of you. He could discuss Obama or the Middle East and things like that. He doesn't get depth, but he understands, he knows what's going on.
It doesn't matter.
But the impact on my life.
That's right.
And the stress, getting a call at 3 o'clock in the morning.
That's terrible.
First of all, it's not the first time. The last time was like a year ago. And I said to them, please don't call me at 3 o'clock in the morning unless there's something I can do.
I got a call 2 o'clock in the morning. It doesn't matter. Whenever it happens, you feel bad, you feel guilty,
sad. I didn't know if I should come to group or if I should go to him. So I called my aide that some of you met, and she's going there. And the psychotherapist that we both see, he's going there.
What happened with your son? Finish your story.
So I waited to call my son until he was out of the ER, and I knew he was being admitted, and I had a little more information. And I told him that his kidney's not working, he has an intestinal blockage, and his pressure was 70 over 40. They had his head all the way down and his feet all the way up in the stretcher. And my son said, Mom, it was like this before, and you're overly dramatic.
Thanks for the backup.
I said, would you prefer I not call you? I asked the doctor, the kidney specialist that is his regular doctor, luckily was right there and was called in as a consult. I said, what should I tell my son? He's telling his father is very, very sick. So it was a difficult day. And I apologize, Murray. I'm annoyed
at
you.
I'll
talk to you one-on-one and I'll resolve.
It's not necessary.
Right. And look, this started off.
I'm sorry.
Well, for those of you that just joined us, it's our Wednesday morning group of what I consider to be our wisdom warriors.
You didn't film this.
And
yes, he did.
And
I know this part.
And so we can. We started with a piece because everybody here has had a difficult situation in the last 24 hours. The whole issue of running a support group is that you never know on any given day what's going to happen, who's going to walk through the door with what issue. But as we opened up with the film, there wasn't anybody here that was not totally sympathetic. And it's not so much that sympathy, it's empathy and support. When we came in, there wasn't anybody here that didn't hug everybody and give them the support that comes from a family in a support group that really cannot be duplicated anywhere else. And as a result of that, these are the kinds of things that all caregivers face at some point in time. And you have to understand this is unscripted, unrehearsed, this is going down just the way it is, and this is life at that edge that caregivers live on. And there are a number of people here, if they continue to share their story, which I hope they will, have had phone calls in the last 24 hours saying that their spouses have stopped breathing, been taken to the hospital, where's their do not resuscitate order. And so this is the kind of mourning that we have started out with. And just as a quick aside, I want to thank ManorCare for allowing us to use their facility. And so why don't we pick it up from there?
Well, on the one point, when I spoke to the nurses and I said, look, it's a selfish question, but I'm supposed to leave with some other women that I met at the support group. and a couple of them are widows, and the others have spouses in a facility like I do. And do you think I'll be able to go? And she said, I think it's wonderful you go to a support group, and I know how hard it is to be a caregiver, and you deserve it, and we're going to take good care of him. I said, I'm going to call later. She says, you can call if you want, but we're going to take good care of him, and don't be concerned. By the way, they put him in what's called a step-down unit.
Yes.
So it's less than an ICU, but right. more but, attention.
But more right. attention than if he were on the floor.
That's what I had. Based on that,
I thought it was important enough, you know, to call my son. And like I said, I got crap. But he did call me later at night, and I told him that he's doing better. And that he could call him in the room.
Mm-hmm. So,
I'm sorry.
No. Don't apologize.
You don't have to be sorry.
Right.
You're a human being.
And one of the things, and I think that when Eleanor jumped in to make her comment, at some point, we're all going to pass away. Some sooner, some later. We've all been through it. All right? Children, loved ones, sisters, brothers, whatever the circumstances may be. And knowing what you have been through doesn't make anybody else's story any different. But you cannot feel guilty, all right, if his time has come. It's not our choice. Many of us here have discussed do not resuscitate, and I mentioned a moment ago that I realized with my uncle was a little different in Philadelphia because they also had a do not intubate, or I would have had a situation where they kept my uncle alive against his wishes because it was only resuscitate and not intubate. Mm. And I would make the recommendation that all of you that have it, if that's your feeling, add those three words, do not intubate.
That was the question I was asking. Does that have to be an addition to do not resuscitate?
Yes. It says do not resuscitate, it
should,
or do not and. Do not intubate. Don't put that tube down my throat to keep me alive a little longer when I'm filling up with fluid.
Do you have to go to the attorney?
I would say that on the DNR form, if you were to take it, write it, have your spouse sign it, all right, or in your representative capacity, and I'd probably even take it to a notary, all right, and say, all right, which you can find, you can go to the bank.
In other words, for myself.
For yourself.
It would just be an additional note.
Exactly. I don't think it requires a legal scribe to write do not intubate with your signature and have somebody notarize it.
Okay.
All right.
Now and we can do it as power of attorney for our spouse?
Excuse me?
Can we do it as power of attorney for our spouse?
Sure. How did that's how you signed his DNR when he went to
the
facility?
Well, he actually was able to sign it.
Okay. But the answer is yes. Yeah. Because otherwise, in half the cases, we wouldn't have a DNR, all right? And so that's very important. And to raise the issue that you did about feeling guilty if he passed away, Eleanor's been through that, Muriel's been through that, Roberta's been through that, Murray's been through that, Betty's been through that. We probably have more here that happened. All right, and the point remains is everybody goes in their moment of crisis kind of reflecting on shoulda, coulda, woulda. What should I have done? What could I have done? What would I have done? You did the best you could under the circumstances with what you had to deal with. And you, not any more or any less than every other caregiver that's here and every other caregiver that's out there, have gone above and beyond in your life in being an unpaid family caregiver. And you should never, ever feel guilty that you haven't given 110% of yourself, because you have. And you have to remember that. It's a very difficult situation, and we tend to beat ourselves up at times because we feel that that's what we ought to do. But I can't tell you don't do it. I can only tell you that you, along with everybody else here, never have to feel guilty about that.
Can I just say, Marion, I don't think there's a person at this table that at some time has said to themselves, I wish it was all over. Mm-hmm. Because not only just for the suffering of yourself, but the suffering of your loved one. And then you say, oh my God, that's a terrible thing to say, but that's not true. That's your actual inner feeling. I'm tired of all this. He's not who he was. She's not who she was. Time has come. The time has come. And don't feel guilty about feeling that way.
Thank you.
When Marty had the stroke, which was totally unexpected, came out of nowhere, and the ambulance came, 911, and I'm following in the car, and I'm saying, I hope when I get to the hospital it's all over. Because he was in the ambulance and I was in the car following. Mm-hmm. I hope it's all over. And then on the other hand, I hope it's not all over. Yeah. So there's a real...
it's a very heavy conflict.
And when he got to the hospital, it wasn't all over, but of course the next 9 months he was totally incapacitated. He couldn't talk, he couldn't walk, he couldn't whatever. And it was like, too bad it didn't happen in the
it's
ambulance.
It's like torture.
Because it was 9 months of hell, yeah. Both of us. Mm-hmm. And then when he died, it was like, it was a relief.
Mm-hmm. Marion, on Mars, when I was called 2:00 in the morning that he had cardiac arrest, I thought that was it, but it wasn't. And the following 3 weeks in MICU and then in hospice, I knew it was coming. It was a question of when, but I didn't look forward to it, but I knew it was coming. And I wished it was over with because of my love for him, mm-hmm. Not because I didn't care and I didn't feel guilty. I had done everything, and the doctors were told to do everything they could. But there comes a time when you have to feel it's the right thing, and a kind of relief settles over you. You know it's inevitable.
The confusion is the fact that because he doesn't have Alzheimer's, mm-hmm. because he only has mild cognitive impairment.
And what about all his falling and all his other
physical? Well, I think that we have to make a small distinction here. Not a small one, maybe a big one. In Muriel's case, it was a stroke. Many of the people sitting around this table, it was dementia. He deserves the dignity of who he is, regardless of the illness. Right. If it was cancer, if it was leprosy, to see somebody suffering and say, I love him, I don't want to see him suffer, irrespective of whether it was Alzheimer's or not, or whatever it may have been, is really
irrelevant.
The mindset that we have to have. We're not doing it because we want to get rid of them.
No.
Yes, it's been a burden, but the love that took you down the trail of doing as much as you did, all right, certainly negates any feeling of guilt. And why would we want to see that person we love suffer needlessly? And I think that's the approach you have to take.
Marion, because we're going through a similar thing, when they first took Mal, they first called me and they took him to the hospital, at first I was a little annoyed because we did have that do not resuscitate order and they did take him to the hospital. And then all of a sudden, after I got annoyed, I did feel very guilty for thinking, why would I leave him back just to do nothing? But when they got him in the hospital and I saw what they were doing to him, that should have not been done to him, all the blood work that they gave him, all the tests that they gave him, wanting to send him to rehab, and how petrified he was because he didn't understand what was happening to him. I guess I started to soften and I looked at him and I said, you know what, It definitely would have been met off. It definitely.
Yeah, I had the same thing with Norman when they...
And I don't know if you've heard the whole story that he did say to me at one time. He did say under his breath, my wishes, my wants, my wishes, my wants. And I knew exactly what he was talking about.
And I
felt helpless because there was nothing I could do for him.
Well, and this is a subject that I want to bring up in a couple of minutes, but I want to let everybody say what they have to say. I constantly am confronted. Yesterday, I had two or three circumstances where, in one, I got a phone call from a gentleman I'd helped with his mother a couple of years back, and she's still in a nursing home. And she has breast cancer. And they took her to the hospital. Excuse me. Took her to the hospital, and they wanted to remove the breast. And he said, what do I do? I said, first of all, you tell them no. I said, how is an 89-year-old woman with COPD who can't get out of her wheelchair? This is the problem these days with medicine, the medical profession. They don't seem to understand, unless it's clearly written on your forehead, do everything. That if it was their mother, their grandmother, their spouse lying on that table, knowing that if they put her through the surgery, if she even survived it, what would recuperation have even looked like? And pain and suffering. And so I said to him, I can't tell you what to do, but I would tell you what I would do, because I had to do it a few weeks ago. And I did it for my own father. And you've heard me tell that story. I won't bother to repeat it. But when I looked at the surgeon and said, who do you think you're operating on? This 89-year-old man? No way. And so these are the situations that we confront every day. And I think that some of the thought process is when we get and we feel guilty, are we doing everything we can? There are many times that doing nothing and letting the course of events take place, but remembering that they're entitled to be pain-free, comfortable, and respect their dignity. And to be laying there on a gurney, punched full of bloodlines, and trying to, and that's another issue I have. There are very, very few people in the ER that have any concept of dementia. And when they see somebody and, oh, you need to go to rehab, and you've got a blank stare, and maybe the caregiver is not immediately there or is not available or whatever, we really have a lot of growing up to do in this country from the medical profession. I have been reading constantly about the fact that once they learn what they learn, they've learned it. Mm-hmm. And that many times the wrong people are making the wrong diagnosis, and they're leaving everything to the primary care physician, who's coming up with whether or not you have a psychiatric issue, whether or not you have Alzheimer's, whether or not you have kidney failure. I'm not saying that they shouldn't be a quarterback, but in this day and age of managed medicine, they're becoming everything, and you cannot be a jack of all trades in medicine.
Dave,
yes.
Excuse me.
But
one quick question.
Yes.
We all, I think, have been where we say to a doctor, any kind of doctor, what would you do if it were your parent, your mother, your sister? And I often wonder, do they give an honest answer?
No. It's not that it's not an honest answer, but when you ask a doctor what is his medical advice or what would you do, he's still putting it in a medical perspective.
Exactly.
And even if you enhance it by saying if it was your mother, your grandmother, they know that the answer they're giving, all right? Rarely have I seen the circumstances where somebody objectively says, I'd let him go.
You're afraid of being sued.
Well, the liability issue is a big one in this day and age, all right? And even if you've got all the paper, you know, that says, I won't, I don't, somebody invariably comes out of the woodwork and says, well, you should have. And this is what happens, which is part of the question you were asking earlier. You go on a cruise, and if something happens while you're gone, they will pull out all the stops. Because nobody wants you to come back from your trip and be told, well, you didn't do everything you could, and you didn't do everything that you should, all right? And I'm suing you, all right? And then we turn on the TV and we figure out which, you know, personal injury attorney we want to go to. I'm not making light of that. I'm simply saying we live in a very strange society. We expect more out of our doctors than they are capable of doing. And when they do certain things, and there was a big article a couple days ago where they were talking about the fact, this particular situation, that aging is not a disease, and that things happen to us as we get older. Our genes are constantly, our cells are constantly turning over, and every iteration makes us a little older, all right? That's why we get our wrinkles, we get our liver spots, we get gray hair. It's part of the badge of honor of making it to a certain point in life. But it's not a disease. And when you walk in and say, oh, to the dermatologist, I have a liver spot, rather than saying, hey, it happens to everybody your age. No, nope. Out comes the nitrous, out comes the this, and we expect from the medical profession, and they're going to do what they can to keep us looking like we were when we were the Pepsi generation, or wherever you want to cast it back to. Now, they made the point in this article about the fact that we're over-treating aging. And I think that's very, very correct. There are things that occur in aging as a consequence. You may get osteoporosis, in which case maybe there's a medication that you should take. We get arthritis, which is not specifically a consequence of aging, but there's nothing wrong with taking something to alleviate the pain, all right? But we're not going to retrofit ourselves. And I think that this society has expected, and I think doctors have been kind of asked to do more than they're capable of doing, with the threat behind it, that if they don't, somebody's going to show up with an attorney and say, you could have done more. And in an aging society, that's going to be a very, very difficult set of circumstances, to take 89 and 91-year-old people and treat them as though they were 61 or 51. And I'm not sure where all of this is heading. There was a very interesting, I know I throw them out because I don't know that everybody reads them, but there was a very interesting study that came out of the Cleveland Clinic the other day. It was Pew, I think, their research. And when they asked people the question of, do you agree with assisted suicide when things look the way they look? Absolutely. 62% of the people said yes. When they asked, do you believe in euthanasia? 73% said yes. So it's not that they didn't agree that somebody should be put out of their suffering. They wanted to hear it in words that didn't stick a finger in their eye. They didn't like the word assisted suicide. And for those that realized that euthanasia was not talking about young people in Thailand, for a long time I thought that's what it was. And everybody here did.
That's good.
All right? But when our animals get sick, and we've talked about this, we euthanize them. I wouldn't want to use for a loved one, we put them down. because we can't put a gun, we can't put a gun in their hand or tell them, take this bottle of pills or get in the car and drive into an abutment. All right? And yet, this whole subject has so many taboos attached to it, so many goblins and witches and cultural issues because of words, when the bottom line is, if somebody is suffering, and there was a young man that had a very difficult case of dystrophy. I mentioned it on the radio a few weeks back. And he said, I'm 39 years old. I have gotten my life to this point. And why can't I? And it was kind of like Tuesdays with Maury. You know, he had a variation of something similar to ALS. And he said, why can't I make the decision about when I would like to leave and not have to do it in the corner of my room, putting a bag over my head to see if I can suffocate? Why can't I call the doctor or somebody and say, I do not wish to suffer any longer and I want out? This is not anything that I bargained for. I don't want a lot of medical heroics. I just want to be let out of my pain and agony. And we have not, as a society, accepted the fact. You know, in the old days, and the reason I kid you guys a little bit about being wisdom warriors, because you are the tribal, not by age, the tribal elders. You know, the others would not know how to kill a deer, make a tent, or sew up a pair of moccasins if they didn't have your wisdom from the things and experiences. That's what's so important about this group. But even when we have, when an Indian elder got sick, all right, they would wish him well, and he would go off in the woods.
Right.
Same thing with an elephant. When they know they're sick, they go off to the elephant burial ground and do what they need to do, and they pass away. It's done by ritual, by circumstance. We do not have a way to let somebody go to the elephant burial ground in a dignified manner to be able to say enough is enough, because somebody is going to turn around and say, you weren't of sound mind.
Isn't DNR the same thing?
No.
It's dependent on other people.
It's dependent on other people, and it's dependent upon... hold on just a second, Betty. I'm going to give you a set of circumstances, all right? You have a loved one. They have cancer. I'm thinking of my mother, all right? And this went back a long time. Today is her 95th birthday. And I called my sister this morning to remind her. And she moved to Florida, and 3 days after she moved here, they discovered that she had inoperable lung cancer. Why? Because her physician back in New York, who operated from the front of the house, had a radiology machine, didn't even know how to read the darn thing, because when we went back afterwards, it was plain as day, you know. But this is when all medicine got practiced in the sun porch. But anyway, make a point. They couldn't operate, and so the first thing they did, we're going to put her through radiation. All right? And so they put her through radiation, and we're going back to the 70s, and it was dirty radiation, you know, at the time. There was no focal beam and all the rest of that stuff. Well, it so burned her that she couldn't swallow anymore. She couldn't eat food. And she suffered every day. And I said, why should this woman, not because it was my mother, but here is a human being who is suffering, who has an endpoint disease, and the cure made it worse. If I had only known then what I know now, I would have said, just leave her and treat a little bit of the pain for the cancer until it reached a point. And then I would have still said, Mom, you don't want this. I understand. Instead, she had to stay alive. I watched her legs break as the cancer attacked the bones. All right, I'm not looking to make this a horror story, but it was a horror story. And just for everybody else's guilt, I brought her back from Florida because my family wanted to see her. They had just moved, and so they had to cut her spinal cord so they could do it, so that she could at least sit
in
a plane.
God.
All right, I'm telling you. I'm telling you this because it's reality.
Poor baby.
And I would sit next to her. All right, she was at my aunt's house because my daughter had just been born, and I didn't have room in my garden apartment. And I would say, Mom, why don't you die? Why can't you pass away and stop the suffering? And I felt, I mean, I was 27 years old, and the guilt was overwhelming. But I knew that this was no way for any human being to have to be. And it was too early in the world. We didn't even know about hospice back in 1971. I mean, it may have been there, but it was not part of the popular culture, or I would have brought it in. And so I know of what I speak. I know how you felt, all right? I know what it's like to sit and look and see somebody you love and adore suffering. And saying, God damn it, what is wrong with the system?
When Dr. Kevorkian stepped in and did his thing to help people in this situation, they put him in jail.
Right. Yes.
And at the time, I remember I was so infuriated. This man was a hero.
Cultural and religious norms.
Yep.
That's right. All right, it's the same people, and I'm not casting aspersions, it's the same people that say, if there is a flicker of life in an egg, then unless the mother's going to die, we can't do anything about it, all right? The mother, even if she's 15 and been raped, she's going to have that baby, all right? And if she lives in Mississippi, for sure, because they closed the last abortion clinic there 3 months ago.
There'll still be abortions. Somebody will
It'll be coat hangers in the alley.
They don't remember those days. Right.
David, I was watching my husband, and he was suffering his own way because he was very frightened.
Sure.
He was extremely frightened. And I said to the nurse, I still remember saying to the nurse, you know, he really does not want to live this way. And her first thing jotting back at me was, then I think we better call in a psychiatrist. Because anyone that says, I don't want to live that way, you know, we got to think about suicide and all this, so we should call in a psychiatrist.
Did you say you're stupid?
Almost, but I was very, very nice about it.
And right.
I
said, it's time for you to have a psychic class.
Really doesn't understand what he's saying. But she was ready to call in.
Right.
I says he really does not understand what he's
saying.
And this
is, unfortunately, the way medicine gets practiced. If you don't stay within the defined guidelines.
Right.
I remember in the old days that when I was running a call center for caregivers, and I was competing with nurse hotlines. And I was talking about non-clinical caregiving, and they were giving out medical instructions. And it was staffed by RNs, and I have no argument with an RN. But they had a screen in front of them. And if you said, I have a cough, it wasn't that you were using their wisdom and knowledge. They'd read it right off the screen, and they were being monitored. If they wandered one word, the call was shut off for fear of liability. So you didn't have help. What you had, respectfully, was monkeys reading a screen. All right? And we carry on that way, that medicine can only be performed one way. Yes, do no harm. But they didn't write the afterpiece to do not hasten death, unless life is absolutely unbearable. And so we have to wait until somebody finally from the medical profession says terminal in 6 months. And I've seen too many circumstances where the doctor gave the fact that they wanted to keep trying to keep the kidneys working, to keep this working or whatever, and would not write the word terminal. And because they were in a nursing home and you wanted to bring in somebody else, they would bar them at the door because they were not an acceptable admit because they weren't on their medical staff.
Approximately, when was DNR accepted?
DNR's been around for a while. I can't, I'd be lying if I could tell you when, but I think
30,
it's...
30, 40 years.
At least.
My father had a DNR, and so they didn't resuscitate him, but they did a prostate operation on a man who died 3 weeks later. I mean, that was like, to me, the most ridiculous thing.
It's money.
He did not need it.
How old was he?
Excuse me.
He was 82, but he was dying.
I'd like to get back to Marion's situation and being on a cruise. What happens if you're with your loved one on a cruise, they get very sick, and they might not make it? If you don't have insurance, how do you get them back to the States?
Pay for it.
Right. First of all...
Well, there's different ways.
I was on a cruise, didn't happen to me. But they do happen to have a couple of, you know, similar to what you would find at a morgue. They have a couple of refrigerated, because not everybody has the ability to have the helicopter fly in. And even though you might want to live with your religious and cultural norms in the middle of the high seas, that may not be an alternative, all right? And if you don't have the insurance,
which a lot of people don't.
All right, and I understand that. Then you're just going to have to wait until you come back to port and act accordingly.
No, there's something else you can do, too. In Boca, they have the angels. These are all pilots that will bring your loved one back free. You give a donation. A lot of people don't know about that.
No, that's a good thing to know.
It's good to know, and they're just supposed to be the most marvelous people.
Right, but they need to own a helicopter.
Oh yeah.
Right.
Oh yeah.
And within the
and then
air
you
range
money,
of the
that's
hell.
A lot of gas, you
yeah.
know. But
all right. I am sure in this day and age that the Coast Guard or something else could be called upon if
thought.
It was that kind of situation.
The right?
Yeah, but yeah. I mean, are you taking an around the world cruise, or did you go, you know, weekend to the Bahamas? There's a difference. This is a cruise of how long?
One week.
One week. No matter what happens in that week, things will go on.
Right.
The wheels will keep turning. All right.
I'm just thinking, if it ever happened to me, how do you handle things like this when you're in such a
if
state of
happens,
mind that you're so crazy in your mind, upset like Marion is today?
Call Murray. If you die on a cruise, call Murray.
Marion,
he'll swim,
no,
he'll swim out.
In the ocean.
He'll swim out.
Marion, can't you give someone for a week while you go on your power of attorney or something, like your sister, so something happens, she'll know what to do.
That's a thought.
Yeah, well,
just like when the kids leave the babies with you, they write out, I don't know about you, I'm going to. They
what's
write
she doing?
There's a joint power of attorney between my son and myself. I think it's an or.
But your son doesn't seem to be
here. He's not
here.
He's in New York.
He's
not here. No, I already spoke to my sister about calling him while I'm away, because I won't have a phone, and I think I can email her and then, you know, let her know and whatever.
Do you feel, knowing how you feel and what you just expressed about, even though he didn't have Alzheimer's, you said to yourself, is this it? Is he, are he and I finally released from the bonds of this illness and all the time that has gone on? Would your son subscribe to that same thinking if he came down here and saw Dad?
Yeah, no, I think that we agree on.
All right.
But he just didn't believe it was as serious as...
Well, suppose he came down and the doctor said, of course it's serious, but we think we can do X and Y. And you know darn well that X and Y is never something that you would want to do. But he says, well, then let's do it because Dad would want this. And I've seen that happen time and again.
That's really what got the issue. In the past, my husband had two serious cases of dehydration. One serious enough, after back surgery, he was in rehab and they didn't monitor his fluids. He got so bad that it's like he fell into instant Alzheimer's overnight. That's what I thought happened.
Right, and dried his brain out.
And it turned out it was so bad they put him on temporary dialysis and he got his function back. And at that time, I spoke to my son about if he needed regular dialysis. And since then, I had a very, very good friend in New Jersey who went through dialysis, and I saw what it did to her. It's a very debilitating thing, if any of you have any experience with it. It's just totally drain all your blood, and you feel like crap.
And you're doing it 3 or 4 days a week.
Oh, right. Well, thank you.
So I spoke to my...
Hanford.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
How's
so
he doing?
I spoke to my son, and I said, they're talking about possibly dialysis. I said, and I don't agree with that. And he said to me, that's you getting overly dramatic.
See, that would be
here.
My only concern,
yeah.
All right, is that he's going to come down and call an audible.
Yeah.
Yep.
All right? And while it is his father, you're the one that's been in the trenches all of these
very
years.
Much so.
And you and your husband have a pretty clear understanding, I think, of what it is you want done, just as what went on, you know, yesterday or last night. And so I think no matter what conversation you had with your son, if he came down, he would in your absence probably act the way he's reacted in the past to similar crises. I can't say that for sure. I'm not condemning him for it, but you may come back and find that a situation that you would have said, please let him go. All right, that he's still here and went through some medical procedure.
I think if you spoke to him and told him in clear, uncertain terms,
that's
this
right.
is what
just
I
thinking.
Want, this is
yeah,
what, this is what you need to do in my absence.
Yes.
What
you can try, but when they're there,
but make it clear
at the
that this
ER
is what I want.
Door and the doctor comes out, just as I had with my uncle, you know, he's filling up with fluid, but I can, you know, intubate him and drain him and do this. And I said, no, his wishes are.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the same kind of situation. Yeah. My sister almost wobbled, if you recall that story.
Yes.
And so the emotion of the moment often drives the words to a different place, especially if it's not the person that has been the constant caregiver and knows intimately what you have all gone through. Your son may understand it, and he's lived through it vicariously through you and at times when he comes down here. But he really can't appreciate the falls on the sidewalk and almost hitting your head on the car stop and the repetitiveness of what went on over and over.
He hasn't
and over.
Seen it.
He,
right.
he hasn't
and
seen
so,
it. He hasn't lived
and,
with it.
And that's not a condemnation.
No.
But if you're not here and you don't appreciate
don't
the circumstances from your eyes, from your brain, from your perspective, I'm not sure that our proxies always will act exactly the way we want in a pressure situation.
It's something I'd like to just say to Marion face to face. You talk to your son, you tell him, these are my wishes, these are your father's wishes, this is what I want you to do. But if he doesn't, you still go away with a clear head, knowing that you've done the very best that you can.
Yep.
And enjoy the cruise and whatever it'll be.
When is the cruise?
Marion,
it's a living
Sunday. This group made me go on my first cruise. Because I was going to do the same thing. My husband was down the hall here then. And we arranged.
We did the same thing with Murray. Made him go to New York.
Right. Yeah. I remember that's when they joined. And it was the best thing I ever did. Because it put everything into perspective.
Cold in here again.
It didn't make it much easier for me.
You have a good time.
We're going to have a great time, Marion.
We're going to have a wonderful time.
Right. And that's the attitude. You know why? Because these 7 days are your days, no one else's. And even if Norman were to pass while you were gone, these are still your days. And you know that it wouldn't, that even if you were here, nothing would have changed. And you so deserve for everything that you've worked for in getting yourself back in shape and losing weight and going through those surgeries and everything that you've done.
You've never stopped.
Right.
It's like
the fact of where you were to where you are now is remarkable.
Yes.
And the fact that you can't say to yourself, these 7 days are kind of my reward, not only for being a good caregiver, but being a good caregiver
to
myself. All right.
Taking care of your husband.
And whatever happens will happen. Yeah. And you'll return and you will deal with it, all right? But don't let that stand in the way and don't feel guilty.
Excuse me. I'm going to follow and your girl's advice.
Excuse me. Can her son override her even though she's got everything in writing?
Yes.
He can do it whatever he wants.
Right.
You know, I was going to, when my sister fell, a few days later I was talking to my niece and I said, well, you live up here. She lives in Palm Beach County. The rest of my family is basically in Dade County. I said, so I need you to be, you know, helpful to me. And if something happens to me, I want you to know I have a DNR. And she said, well, I would not follow it.
What?
Well, she would not.
No, so I'm not going to use her. But,
yeah.
but I know.
Freddie has my a service.
recently, my sister apparently said to my niece, why did you keep me alive? I don't want to be alive.
Well, you need to back that up and explain that very recently your sister had...
My sister fell and had brain damage and has brain damage. And she can talk a little bit, but she forgets. You know, it's getting better a little at a time. And she's just not happy. I mean, this is not the way she wants to live.
Right.
And my
niece
said
she was...
You
know, it's kind of irony.
Yeah. My niece said, well, you know, I've learned you can't... You know, she felt sad now. Of course, I think she would have lived either way.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a difficult decision, and you can't override what someone wants. But people do that.
Yeah.
I mean, the three children, we're not going to let her die.
But I don't understand. If everything's in writing, how can somebody
do that? You can put whatever you want in writing at the moment of truth when it says power of attorney or healthcare proxy and says, these are my wishes. But you still have the ability to kind of interpret it. The doctors
your
are
way.
Going to go through and read it and say, oh, well, he wanted this, he didn't want that. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Well, why do we have laws?
Why do we have laws? Because this is the way our country is constructed. And I would say that in the majority of cases, that those written documents are followed. But the way that they really get followed is not to write them, put them in the safe, tell somebody you're on them, is to sit down with the family and say, look, your mother and I, your father and I have given this a lot of thought. And what we put down here is what we believe in. Mm-hmm. And we do not want to be sitting in that wheelchair, laying in that hospital bed, a shell of ourselves, whatever. You don't even have to get to the vegetable stage. And it is our sincere desire that if you are called upon to do this, that you will follow our directions because this is what we want.
Yeah.
And just like in football, I don't want you changing the play at the last minute and calling an audible. All right? And if something were to radically happen, then we'll change our advanced directive or our healthcare surrogacy because all of a sudden what we're afflicted with has a very strong chance of being survived, all right? That's our decision. It's our decision for our bodies, our lives, and we respect you as our children, as our siblings, whatever. But you need to honor it. And if you have that family meeting beforehand, and every now and then when you get together for turkey time, or Hanukkah, or Christmas, you reinforce it. Not to turn it into gloom and doom, but the more that you let people know, and those that you've empowered, and not just leave it as some, oh my God, you know, the document came out, and here I am at St. Somebody or Other's ER, and what am I supposed to do? Yeah, I'm reading this thing, but that's Dad.
Yeah.
And they don't, if you're in an emergency situation where someone is on the cusp, of living. I don't think that people take out their paper and look to see if there's a DNR or not. They just work.
You're absolutely right. No. And there's been litigation that has surrounded this as to where and when and how and who, all right? And literally, when you get to that ER, they're going to pull out all the stops. You could have your DNR pasted on your forehead. It's when they either stabilize you or say you're starting to flatline or whatever, and you say, if that happens, do not resuscitate him here. I don't want him shocked. I don't want the needle in his chest to see whether or not the adrenaline or whatever can bring him back.
And you have to stay on
the road. Yes. I think that
if that's the case, that's the case.
I think that I pretty much, hopefully, have that in order with my family, especially with my daughters. We've talked about it several times. You know, what my wishes are, what his wishes would have been. And then, of course, this week when this happened, and he said that, he told us, actually, he doesn't want it like this. And I think, hopefully, everything is understood by everybody.
Okay. David, why would someone recommend a psychologist for a man with Alzheimer's who's able to express himself to basically say, this isn't the life I want?
Money.
Before we go to money, it's also...
What can I say? Cover your backside?
Yeah.
Everybody wants to make sure that somebody else has written the paper, signed off on this. I mean, one of the big problems, and it's being raised here, is that when somebody does want to have, and I'm going to call it assisted suicide, you can call it euthanasia, typically they need to get a sign off from two psychiatrists. At least that's the way it is out on the West Coast. What psychiatrist who has somebody walk in the door and say, I'm suffering and I really want to put myself out of my misery, is not going to either Baker Act them or say, you're not sane enough to make that kind of a decision, and if you were, I would consider you to be off the wall for wanting this. They are not trained to let people go. They are trained to cure them. And when we have people like hospice, it's not that they're accelerating it, but they're acknowledging that people are entitled to dignity, being pain-free, and an environment where people understand that there's life and then there's death. And we need to make, when our children are born, we cut the umbilical cord. All right, we put them in a layette. They watch them very carefully. They do the Apgar test. All right, and when they're strong enough and well enough, we take them home. And the process grows from there. So we taper up. Why can't we have that when we taper down? Mm-hmm. All right, and why shouldn't we, as grown adults, make a conscious decision? Because look, if we were out there and not laying in the nursing home, and we said enough's enough, it's the Irving story. I take out my Glock and I end it, all right? But that's a very tough way to treat your family, all right? You know, to wind up smashing into an abutment in your car or doing something, that gives you total control, but is such a difficult thing to do. We do not have that mechanism yet. We're working on it. The Netherlands does.
When I left the hospital for the evening yesterday, I went up to the nurse's station. I was sure that they had my home phone number, my cell number. And then I said to them, you know that he has a DNR. And I was pleasantly surprised to find out that they did get that information from Medicare.
Okay.
However, when he was first admitted into the ER, they hadn't put down that he vomited, which is a very big clue.
Right, as to what's going on.
Afterward, that with a concussion, that you have vomiting. It turned out it wasn't a concussion.
Right.
But I got there about 15 minutes after he got there, or less. And they didn't know any information, basic information about him. I don't know if they don't read the chart first, they just look at the patient. She said to me she wanted to take a rectal temperature. I said, he doesn't have a rectum. Oh.
Oh, well, so, he had a colostomy and he's got a bag.
Yeah, so they close up the rectum.
All right.
So, but then I told the nurse he had vomited. Then the doctor came in, the ER doctor, and I told him of his past history and the cardiac bypass and this and that and the other. And I said, and you know about the vomiting. He said, no, you didn't tell me. I said, well, I told the nurse. Oh. So as an advocate, which is David O's always saying,
yeah.
I was very glad I was there.
Yes.
Because at least, you know.
You are the keeper of the record.
Right. Yeah. At that point, he wasn't terminal, mm-hmm. you know, and he isn't. And his quality of life is not so bad as.
All right, then go away realizing that you'll probably be here when you come back and enjoy yourself.
Yeah,
right.
You need to get away.
Yeah.
You really do.
Oh, silent one.
Yes, sir.
What? We other than Murray and my pontificating, we haven't heard from you today.
No, because I'm just thinking back many, many years when my father had a cerebral hemorrhage. And I was away on business in Buffalo, New York, and I drove all night to get home to hopefully that he would still be in the hospital. And I walked into his hospital room, and he was in bed on a machine plugged into his thing.
Right.
And I didn't recognize the man. He was so full of fluid and so breathing, so high and heavy. And what for? Because I was told that he would only be a vegetable if he lived.
Right.
And so I have two brothers. My older brother agreed with me that we should pull the plug,
mm-hmm.
and my younger brother didn't. So they didn't pull the plug. So, but he did die in the middle of the night.
Okay.
Whether they in the hospital pulled the plug, I don't know.
Well, the point was 1-2. The two got outvoted.
Yeah.
All right. And this happens an awful lot with siblings in crisis situations. You're killing daddy.
Yeah.
All right. And the other two clearly know that daddy wanted this, but somebody has not atoned or whatever. And so, and sometimes you just have to take the bull by the horns, you know. And I know you didn't want to alienate your brother, but. You and your brother understood, the two of you, that this was no quality of life. And what did your younger brother, and you don't have to get into this, think he was doing by leaving him in this absolutely horrid position?
Right.
Okay.
You know, my father-in-law turned to me for almost everything once my mother-in-law was sick. And so, he ended up having heart attacks, and then he would come live with me. But this last heart attack, he was dying, and came to me to decide whether to intubate him so that my brother-in-law in Miami had time to drive from Miami to Davie, which is where he was. And I ended up doing it, but I felt guilty because I knew he didn't want that. But I did it for my brother-in-law. So the question is, how do you make that decision as a, you know, I did ask, is he going to live if I do it? Is what's going to happen? You know, his
what's going to happen
to his brain?
Right.
You know.
Yeah, ask good questions, but tag, you were it.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
And sometimes we get put in situations that we don't ask for.
Right.
And we make decisions that we hope are right. And in hindsight, we can be very cruel to ourselves for what we should have, could have, would have.
Well, as it turned out, my brother-in-law got there, they held hands and whatever, and then he passed away.
Okay,
so,
then that was a good ending to what was going to be a bad story.
Right.
We have a couple of minutes left. I just want to say that I thought that today's session was one of the more moving. All right. I can't believe week after week when we do this, the candor and the directness and
your ability to articulate what you've been through and reflect on what others sitting around the table have been through as well. And we share these not so much as war stories, but to show, and the public needs to realize this, that life's a great equalizer. We all started off doing different things in our lives, living our lives, and now we're at a point in our lives where there's a lot of commonality in what we've been through. Maybe not the unique circumstances of the illness, but the circumstances that, in our wisdom, we have come together to share, and for that matter, compare, and to lend support to one another, because that's what this is all about. And to people that will have the opportunity to see this, they need to understand that these support groups aren't put on to be sensational. They're put on to be educational, to make people who do not have the benefit of your collective wisdom and understand that these things have to be shared, that you have to get these emotions out, that you can't just sit in a corner and hope things will happen one way or the other. And yes, whatever your higher power is, you hope that that will happen, but we are also very mortal people, and things happen to us. And when we do, we have to make hard decisions, all right? And we only hope that we're making the right decision in a tough situation. And it's what I've said all along. The wisdom that you have to understand your options so that you do the best you can with what you have at the time you have to make that decision is the comfort that you take away. It's the peace of mind that you did what you could do, and that's what your loved one would have expected, that's what you expect, and that it'll work that way. All right. I want to thank each and every one of you.
Thank you.
I cannot believe what went on here today, even though I've been doing this for 27
Very
years,
different.
Each time you guys get together.
But it was good. It's needed.
Of course
it
it's wonderful. Needed. And the people that will see this and understand.
And they're probably going through some of this, too.
Everybody's going through this. I'm going through. Everybody at the table is going through what they're going through.
Some sort of.
Yes, exactly.
Yes.
Nobody's exempt from it.
No.
We all live life. We're all human beings. Rich, poor, good, bad. This is the roll of the dice, and we have to play it the way it comes up. And for those of you out there that will see this, I hope you can take some comfort that support groups work, that these people are telling it to you like it is. It's unscripted. It's very raw. It's in the moment. And I think if you're watching it, you will know and understand that.
We're very fortunate that we have each other.
Yes,
yes, definitely.
This is this is a wonderful family.
Yeah, and, I was so excited. I have to say, I was so excited today to come here because I needed you guys so badly.
Well, we're glad
really
we can be here
me.
For
just
you.
Just seeing you help her.
Yes,
right.
You know. That's good because we're all there for each other.
Okay.